Now, the likelihood that you're going to hurt yourself with calcium supplementation is very small. It's one of the nutrients we say, look, you can take it. It's probably not going to hurt you, but it, you know, it also may not be helping you. And in that regard, it is hurting you because you're spending money on something that's not necessary per se and isn't going to help you. And some newer research would even argue that taking high doses of calcium without vitamin K and without magnesium could be potentially problematic for a person as well. So my advice to you, if you're going to use a calcium supplement, you always want to take, so let's make some room up here. So if you're going to supplement with calcium, we want a 2-to-1 ratio with magnesium. So in calcium, we want, so let's say, for example, you're taking 600 milligrams of calcium. You want at least 300 milligrams of magnesium, maybe more depending on whether or not you're magnesium deficient. But if you're going to supplement these two, you want to supplement with them together unless there's a contraindication like kidney disease or something like that. So again, if you're supplementing. Now, what kinds of supplements for calcium are good? What kinds are bad? You know, there's a laundry list of different products and supplements out there on the market. So which one of them, you know, is the better form? The best form of calcium, supplementally speaking, depends, because if we're talking about intracellular or extracellular calcium, sometimes there's a difference. But so let's talk a little bit about forms of calcium. You've got carbonate, which is the oyster shell or bone fragment stuff, which is not really any good. Carbonate is really bulky, so it comes in these massive horse pills, but your body doesn't absorb it very well. So this is probably, if we say, okay, which one do I not want to use? Carbonate's not a great form. There's something called hydroxyapatite. So calcium hydroxyapatite is another form, and it's a bone matrix supplement, and it's fair. It's a good form. But then you have citrate, arguably the better of the versions of calcium. I'll put a little star by it. You've got citrate malate, you've got calcium malate, and then you've got calcium orotate. And so if we're talking about just good old-fashioned, tried and true, what the research says as far as absorption rates, this is it right here. This is where your money's at, is calcium citrate. One of the best forms. And generally speaking, the pill size is reduced to a certain extent. Not quite as huge of a pill, although they still are pretty big pills. Now, if you're talking about intracellular calcium, like some research, again, this is not, when I say this is not mega conclusive, meaning this is still, there's still research that should probably be done, but calcium orotate is good at getting inside the cell. So whereas calcium citrate's good at getting absorbed through the GI tract, getting into your bloodstream, orotate is really good at getting inside your cells. So intracellular calcium. So, you know, that is something to be considered if maybe you've been told you had a calcium deficiency by your doc and you were non-responsive to calcium citrate, you might look toward orotate as a potential form to get your calcium in you. So these are your basic forms. Again, carbonate's no good, calcium hydroxyapatite, calcium citrate, calcium malate, calcium orotate. Preferably always taken in a 2-to-1 calcium magnesium ratio, and preferably taken with vitamin K. And when I say taken with vitamin K, it's why I'm a big fan of food. So going back to what we talked about here, vitamin K, lots of vitamin K, vitamin K here. You get vitamin K when you take it in with your food, because nature knows already that putting the two together, you know, vitamin K is necessary to push calcium into the cell. It's one of the important factors there. So again, if you're going to supplement, consider vitamin K as an important element to be able to drive calcium into the cell. So consider what your diet is, because if your diet's a poor source of vitamin K, then you might really want to consider changing your diet instead of, again, changing your diet first instead of supplementing. If you're doing this all on your own without, you know, without somebody guiding you, without a doctor, try it with food first. Food is, you're going to have a hard-pressed time hurting yourself with food if the food fits the definition of what real food is, right? I'm not talking about fruit. I'm not talking about highly processed stuff that we call food. I'm talking about real wholesome foods that are important and necessary for your body to function. Okay, so maybe I didn't answer how much calcium should a person be taking. So, like, depends. If we're talking about a therapeutic dose, you know, 1,000 to 1,200 milligrams of calcium per day. So, you know, don't really recommend anybody look to try to go beyond that. You don't necessarily need to push more than that if your diet is adequate. Now, are there toxic symptoms of calcium? Meaning, can you take too much? Look, some cultures, there's some tribal cultures that generally thrive largely on milk, and their dietary intake of calcium is 5,000, you know, plus milligrams a day. And in that culture, we don't really see any signs or symptoms of calcium toxicity. But where I would say you got to be careful and be cautious is, one, if you've got a kidney disorder in your kidney, there could be a problem with your kidney not properly absorbing, reabsorbing, or letting go of calcium appropriately. Additionally to that, pay attention to lethargy. If taking calcium makes you really tired and makes you feel really, really foggy, it's probably not for you. It's probably not a good idea for you to take it. But beyond those things, again, it's really hard to become toxic in calcium. Remember, you have this huge skeletal structure that's predominantly made in large part by calcium. So it's not going to be super, super easy. It's not one of those nutrients that can cause massive levels of toxicity, especially not at these levels. Again, if you've got a kidney disorder, that's a different matter. You should follow up with your nephrologist or your kidney doc before you are taking heavy levels of electrolyte-based supplements anyways. Hey, and if you missed the earlier part of this series, click right here so you can go back and get caught up. The information there might be critical to helping you on your path to better health. And as always, thanks for tuning in. Make sure you subscribe for updates below. Have a great day.